I'm Lisa Robbins with Let My People Know, and I'm here for a little small talk with Lori Gottlieb, author of New York Times bestseller, Marry Him, The Case for Settling for Mr. Good Enough. Welcome, Lori.
Thanks for having me.
So this book, I understand, has caused quite a firestorm of controversy. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what the book is about? Because there's been a lot of discussion about what it is and what it isn't. So let's hear a little bit about the book.
Yeah, I think a lot of people, you know, I think the controversy is mainly about the title as opposed to what's actually in the book. You know, the title, Settling for Mr. Good Enough, comes from a survey where men and women were asked, if you got 80% of all of your ideal qualities, everything you want in a partner, do you think you'd be happy? And 93% of women said 80%. No, that's settling. And the majority of men said 80%. That's a catch. That's great. That's what I'm hoping for. And so the question that the book, you know, explores is, what does it mean to be happy in love? And because I happen to be a single woman and because I happen to be a journalist, you know, I had a vested interest in getting an answer to that question. So in the book, I go around to neurobiologists to talk about chemistry. I talk to psychologists about what their studies show actually makes people happy in love versus the things that we're looking for when we're dating. I talk to sociologists about how the culture informs our decisions. I talk to behavioral economists about demographics and how we make choices. You know, I mean, I talk to matchmakers, dating coaches, rabbis, our mothers, and about 200 single and married people, men and women, to really try to get an answer to that question, what makes for long-term romantic happiness?
So I think it was on your website where you say it's not that we should stop looking for Mr. Right, it's about changing our perception of who Mr. Right is and considering real requirements. Can you sort of tell us more about that? I know I read a little about, you know, looking for the 8 and not the perfect 10. Maybe talk about sort of what you've learned personally and what you learned through your research and what could help women in their 30s and 40s and on sort of shed light on what they could be doing differently to really find Mr. Good Enough?
Yeah, well, I mean, I should clarify again, Mr. Good Enough really is Mr. Right. And the point of saying Mr. Good Enough is that, you know, we're Ms. Good Enough. And I know we don't like to think of it that way. But somebody in the book said to me at one point, instead of having this long list of all of these qualities that you're looking for in a partner that he must have, you know, he has to be sensitive, but he doesn't cry. He's got to be ambitious, but he wants to change the diapers, you know, like all these different things that you have. You know, he has to like hiking. He has to do this, that, and the other thing. He said, I want you to make a list of everything that a partner would have to put up with to spend the rest of his life with you. And I think a lot of us don't think about that when we're dating. We think about, you know, what we want, but we don't think about the compromises somebody else would have to make. And in fact, when I was, you know, writing down some of these things, you know, they're sort of the obvious things. And then, but it wasn't a very long list. And it wasn't because, you know, I'm have this inflated ego necessarily. It's just that I think that a lot of us think that our flaws are kind of cute and quirky and endearing. And that, you know, somebody's going to find them adorable. And isn't it just so cute the way I'm really perfectionistic and don't want people to touch things on my desk? It's like, no, that's really annoying. And it makes you really rigid and hard to live with. And so, you know, I think that it's about realizing that we're all imperfect people. And so this book is really about finding the perfect partner and not the perfect person. And a lot of us have trouble making that distinction.
I was really struck by, I think it was an Oprah Winfrey episode I saw recently where they had the millionaire matchmaker on and they had this girl in there who was beautiful in her 40s. And, you know, why couldn't she meet somebody? Well, on her list was, you know, I don't like guys that drink out of straws. You know, that's...
Well, you know, it's funny because there's a survey in the book where men and women were asked what would be a deal breaker for going on a second date. And men named 3 things. They said she has to be cute enough and she does not have to look like Angelina Jolie despite what... You know, men can actually differentiate between fantasy and reality better than women can, which is surprising. That was surprising to me. So she has to be cute enough, attractive to him. She has to be warm and kind. She can't be, you know, like... kind of stuck up and that kind of thing. And she has to be nice to the waiter, all of that. And she has to be interesting to talk to. And she gets another 2 hours. We're talking about a second date. Women named 300 things, 300, that would prevent them from going on a second date with a guy. And we're not saying, you know, marry the guy. We're saying spend another 2 hours and maybe get a free dinner.
Not anymore. It seems to be about coffee these days.
See, oh yeah, coffee, exactly. You know, then maybe actually, you know, go spend another 2 hours doing whatever, doing something fun, go to a movie, go hiking, you know, go to dinner, whatever it is. But they wouldn't do it. And they were things like, you know, he wore a brown belt with black shoes and he's really unstylish. Or we were having a great time and he was really kind of cute and smart and funny, but then he did this Austin Powers impression and I just can't get that out of my head. And the reason that people can rule people out based on one or two seemingly insignificant things is because we have the illusion, especially in today's culture, that there are just like thousands of other men out there that, you know, this guy, we'll just go log on to Match.com or JDate or whatever it is, and there will be another guy that doesn't do an Austin Powers impression. And it just, you know, but what they don't realize is there will be another guy who doesn't do an Austin Powers impression, but there will be something else.
That all sounds very familiar somehow.
I mean, in the book, you can read all the reasons and what the deal breakers are. And at first you think, I'm not like that woman. I'm not like any of these women. And then you start to really, you know, talk to your friends and they'll tell you, you know, actually you are.
Well, some of the debates I've had with my friends, and maybe this is, again, some of not understanding quite what the book is about, is sort of grappling with, well, you know, how can I settle, you know, and not have chemistry? That's been a big...
You shouldn't. I mean, there's this book is absolutely about finding someone that you have chemistry with, that you're attracted to, that you feel passionate toward. It has nothing to do with lowering your standards. Really what this book is about, it's about having really high standards, but about the right things. And I think that, you know, it would be very simplistic to say that, well, we're too picky. What the book is about is that we're too picky about the things that don't matter, but actually we're not picky enough about the things that do matter. Chemistry is something that does matter, but I think we have to really understand what chemistry is. And there's an entire chapter in the book that kind of really breaks down different aspects of chemistry and what true chemistry is versus that sort of infatuated butterfly sparks thing. And a lot of people will go out on a first date with someone and say, oh, I had a great time. Yeah, it was pretty fun, but yeah, no sparks. Not going to go out again. And it's like, you had a great time, but you're not going to go out again. And when I interviewed married people, a lot of them said, yeah, I wasn't attracted to my husband on the first couple of dates. Right? I wasn't like unattracted to him, mm-hmm. but I wasn't, you know, I just didn't, did I feel like sparks and butterflies and all of that? Was I swept off my feet? No. And sometimes that takes a while to develop. And sometimes it's there right away. And sometimes it's not. But the thing about chemistry is a lot of us confuse those sparks with what chemistry is. That's just attraction. That's just sort of initial attraction. Chemistry is actually the getting each other thing. You know, do you guys get each other? Do you have that kind of chemistry? And that's getting each other globally, you know, on all different levels. And that's really, really what you want to find in a partner. And a lot of people, what they do is they have sort of what they consider a chemistry, like an attraction or, you know, like how they are physically with each other as like a 9. But then they have a compatibility of maybe a 5. But they don't realize that because they're so kind of swept away by the chemistry. They think like, we both love sushi and we both love Casablanca and we both love, you know, Woody Allen and, you know, whatever it is. And you know, of course we're going to agree on like, you know, how we do the finances and whether we want kids and how many we want and who's going to take care of them and what our values, do we have shared values? They just assume that all that's there because they're so, quote, in sync, you know, because of this chemistry. But then they start to realize later on when that infatuation, the butterflies kind of go down, and what the studies show, there's somebody in the book, a scientist who puts people in MRI machines and looks at chemistry, it lasts a year and a half to 3 years max, that stage of chemistry. And once that goes away, you know, is the real chemistry there, the getting each other, the simpatico? And that includes the physical attraction. And so, but a lot of people don't look at it so holistically like that. And they forget that, you know, what's going to be left after that kind of like, oh my God, I have to, you know, breathe this person's air every second stage goes away.
So what advice, sort of my last question, what advice do you have for singles about how to handle their Jewish mothers who are out there shopping for their husbands and wives, for their daughters and sons, or getting on their case about getting married or dating?
The Jewish mothers really, you know, They get some things right. Now, they get a lot wrong, and I think the book talks about the difference between those two things, but they do get a lot right, and so I think that, you know, don't dismiss your mothers entirely. Listen to what they have to say. Have good boundaries, and, you know, but seriously, they do have some good things to say.
I think a lot of mothers and daughters will both appreciate what you just said.
For sure.
Well, Lori, thank you so much for being with us here today and shedding light on this very important topic of not only finding Mr. Good Enough, but finding Mr. Right.
My pleasure.
This is Lisa, and this has been a production of Let My People Know, an outreach and engagement initiative. Thanks again.